I think as far as the economy is concerned, change is definitely here. And why do I say so? If you look at the direction this economy, indeed this nation, had been travelling in previously, really very much dependent upon oil. So when oil price was high, Nigerians felt fantastic. Oil price collapses, Nigerians are miserable, and we found ourselves in recession. I agree, things are tough for a lot of Nigerians, but I can tell you things would have been a lot worse if you didn't have a president like President Buhari in at the moment, at this time in the economy. Because remember, what happened in the economy was going to happen anyway. The only thing we could do was to try and manage that process. What did we do? We saw that there was a recession and there was problem ahead, and we therefore expanded our budget and began to spend. We've seen countries in recession for 4 years, 5 years. Ours was painful, but it was 5 quarters rather than 5 years. So we pumped money into the economy massively to reflate the economy. We bailed out the state governments. Why? Because once the states don't pay salaries, the entire economy shuts down. So we had to step in and support the states through that very difficult period. We had to pump money through the budget into the economy to ensure that contractors could rehire. We saw thousands of people who had been laid off. So it was a very difficult situation. I think we've managed it very well. I do agree with you that for a lot of people, things are tough, but things are getting better. This government has also been done a lot that is pro-poor. We've recognised the needs of the very poorest among us. We've done NPower, where we've taken on 200,000 unemployed graduates, paid them consistently a stipend while they wait to get a permanent job, or giving them some work experience or some opportunities, in the community. School meal programme. Over 7.5 million children fed every day. For some kids, that's the best meal they get. You know, these are real innovations that this government has brought in, and I think things are definitely going to continue to improve.
There is no state in the Federal Republic of Nigeria where this government is not building one road project or the other, whether it is a new project or projects that were stalled or that we have reactivated, so that we just improve the connectivity of the road network and the transport network to support business. When countries spend on infrastructure, they have many things that they seek to achieve. They seek to grow the size of support that will drive their economy. And that is why the saying is true, that a nation cannot grow bigger than the quality and the size of its infrastructure. So they seek to grow their economy and the size of opportunity. But the interesting thing is that is the end game. The first thing that a commitment to infrastructure does is that it drives the acquisition and the production of plant and equipment, trucks, demolition equipment, drilling equipment, and so on and so forth. That's the first thing it does. What that does immediately is that it drives the demand for lubricants. So if you go and look in that MBS report, petroleum industry sector grew again astronomically from lubricants. Because once the trucks are working, you are buying more diesel, you are buying more fuel, you are buying more grease to run them. And all of this equipment have to be operated by men and women. That means jobs. Beyond all of this, it drives drilling and mining in the quarries and the mines, and it drives transportation, because the equipment, the stone, the sand, now have to be transported from the mines to the contractor's batching plant. It drives raw labor, which is what is used in the batching plants and the works here, to cast concrete for drainage, for bridge. And as you begin to see that, if you go to any construction site, the next thing you see are food vendors. Around them are people who are investing, supplying water. It's an ecosystem of human engagement. The end game is the delivery of the road, the bridge, or whatever infrastructure to now provide service. So in terms of what it will change, that is what is changing. People begin to be busy. Money is moving. Demand for food increases. People get home at night and can put money on the table. They can wake up in the morning with dignity in their heart and say, I'm going to work, as distinct from I'm going to beg. That's what changes.
Buy Niger initiative, which is the idea of encouraging local production, is also working. You know, I'm sure you know that executive order 3 deals with government procurement to say that 40% of what we procure, goods and services, must be locally made. We have never had anything like that before. So I think there is just a raft of initiatives that we have undertaken as a government. If you look at what we met, you know, power, which is so critical for industrialization, we barely had 2,500 to 3,000 megawatts of power available. Today that has doubled. And in terms of production by the generating companies, you know, we have over 7,000 that is available for the grid, and another 3,000 that is coming in. In fact, the Minister of Power, Works and Housing has been talking to the manufacturers about taking 2,000 megawatts of power directly to industry without going through the grid, because the grid is being obviously expanded. The transmission can handle probably about 7,000, but we're producing well in excess of that. This is remarkable because, you know, if it took us 16 years to provide, you know, 2,500, and you double that in 3 years, I think you'll agree with me that that's, you know, fast-paced change. And the same thing can be said of the rail network, where, you know, yes, there are agreements and discussions with the Chinese, but we have done more in the last 3 years to make those agreements real and to implement the rail infrastructure program than we did in the last 16 years. I think you can say the same thing about roads and the road network. I mean, all the states have active road construction going on. You know, I come from the Southeast, and I can tell you that the Port Harcourt Enugu Highway, which is a very critical link road in the East, that now there are workers on site and it's going very well. So those things are visible. And I believe that, like, we're getting to a stage where the evidence is incontrovertible, it's compelling, it's clear, and I believe that the Nigerians will give credit. We're honorable, so we'll give credit where it's due, and we expect that credit to start coming in.
This government have made a commitment of close to 3 trillion Naira to the road sector. Our contractors are back on site. Persons, trades, businesses have returned consequent upon this investment by the federal government. So all our sites are active. A lot of businesses have sprung up around those construction sites. Quarry, sale of cement, wire rods, remotely linked to it is trade. Person selling food, person providing some small services around the construction sites. These are increasing businesses consequent upon the investment of government in that. Now, funding of these projects have also been a little bit diversified in the sense that persons are encouraged to come and look at a particular component of a road infrastructure and invest in it, and they get paid using tax credits. We have also now looked at another funding system, and we have floated the Sukuk bond for 100 billion, which was oversubscribed to the tune of 105 plus billion, which is the first in the history. It tells you two things: the confidence of people in our economy, the confidence of people in the government, the confidence of people and companies and entities in the institution of the federal government of Nigeria today under the leadership of our principal, President Muhammadu Buhari.
We had paid lip service to a diversified economy for more than 50 years. Every government that came talked about diversification, but just by words of mouth. This is the first time in the history of Nigeria that diversification is coming alive. We will get to a point that we won't have to depend on oil again. Agric is coming up fast as an alternative to oil. Mining is also coming up. Manufacturing is coming up. That's changed. To a large extent, the administration has lived up to its promise. For those who thought that change was a magic wand, they may claim not to see it. But for those who recognize that change is a process, they know that that process is in motion. It is well and alive, and the result will be delivered to them. What was the state of the economy in 2015? We had an economy that had collapsed, or rather, an economy that had been primed for collapse. Economists say that the Nigerian economy began to slow down in 2012. And curiously, that was a time when oil was at its highest. Between 2012 and 2014, oil prices oscillated between $100 per barrel to $120. It reached $143 per barrel. But the economy began to slow down simply because the money accruing from oil was not properly utilized. The money went into private pockets. The money was frittered away. By 2015, when the administration came, the government was already borrowing to pay salaries. The then coordinating minister of the economy, Dr. Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala, is on record as saying that by the time the administration exited, it was borrowing to pay salaries. Why should we borrow to pay salaries at a time oil prices had hit the roof? The kind of money this country never made before. So that was the kind of economy this government inherited. And it was no surprise when in 2016 the economy went into recession. Nobody could have stopped it. It was already prime. But then the success story is that recession lasted for just a year. There are economies that went into recession were there for 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. In just 1 year, through deft footworks, Nigerian economy came out of recession. And you will see that the economy that revived with about 1.09 growth is now reaching 3.5 something. The last figure I saw was 2.9, and the forecast from World Bank and IMF is that Nigeria may reach 3.5% growth this year. It shows a lot that the government is doing. So all those who are saying we have not seen the impact on the economy, they will see it. The economy did not go into recession in 1 year. It slowed down from 2012, went into recession in 2016. So how do you expect that in 1 year you will see the impact in the people's pockets? When the economy exited recession and the president spoke, he said, I'm glad we have exited recession, but my joy will be full when it begins to impact on the lives of the ordinary people. And we're on the road to that point when the recovered economy will impact on the lives of people. Rice sold for 20,000 naira per 50 kg bag at a time. That same rice is 15,000 now. At festive season, Lake Rice, which is a collaboration between Lagos and Kebbi States, sells for 12,000 naira. A time will come when rice will drop to 7,000, 5,000 per bag in this country. We should commend this administration for giving us a diversified economy.
Oh, definitely. So much has changed in the country. If it is the economy, we have done far more than our opponents are willing to concede to us. This country has recorded significant growth in terms of solid minerals, development, agriculture has grown. When we took power, electricity available to Nigerians was between 2,500 to 2,600 megawatts. Today, what we have available is more than 7,000 megawatts. Of course, the discourse as we have in our cities have the limitations in their capacity as to how much they take. 5,000 out of the 7,500 that is available. But the government has innovated a scheme by which there is now a direct sale. This excess power of about 2,500 can be sold to bulk buyers so that the wastage itself is reduced. There is so much that is being done to transform road and rail infrastructure. The existing 3,000 kilometers of monorail scheme that we had, you know, has been handed over now to GE, the American company General Electric. They are going to mend a lot of the problems that are there. They are bringing in a lot of coaches, and the old train service that this country had known is coming back. But in addition to that, the government has established a new standard gauge railway scheme that is faster, that is more efficient. And already Kaduna, Abuja, which the previous administration began, has been completed and commissioned. We will commission Lagos Ibadan this year. And all of the contracts broken as they are between Lagos and Kano have now been awarded. And the government is now looking at Lagos Port Harcourt. As a matter of fact, the president's directive is that every state capital of the federation must be linked to the new standard gauge railway scheme. We have achieved a stable naira. This is a dream of many administrations in the past. Nigerians and investors from abroad can have a view of a stable naira that has been there, and the parity achieved more or less between what is the so-called official rate and unofficial bureau de change rates. This merger is a significant achievement that a lot of people must come to appreciate.
Oh, definitely. You ask any Nigerian pensioner and he will tell you that he never knew that they'll be treated the way they're being treated in PITAD. PITAD is one of those agencies that are actually showing Nigerians that change is possible. We had a group of war-affected police officers who had been granted amnesty in year 2000. That was 17 years ago, and they were never paid their pensions and gratuities. So PITAD now went to verify those pensioners. And to me, that was one of the most emotional days. And yes, know that these pensioners cut across the whole of the South-South and the South-East, who were on the other side of the federal government during that sad civil war. These are men in their 80s and 90s. And one of them had said to me that he knows the monthly pension we're going to pay them is very little. But to him, that payment will signify that Nigeria has accepted them back and forgiven them, that this is all he's waiting for before he dies. I was moved close to tears. So we set up the verification in Enugu, and we went with the president of the NUP for the police pension department, Ideli Soyakilome. He was there with us in Enugu. And seeing this group of men and women gathered, you know, so elated and close to tears, and all they were saying that no other government remembered them except Buhari's government. Actions speak louder than words. With that singular action, they have now understood and believed that Buhari is an equitable man. He does not discriminate against one group to the other. He hates social injustice. And that non-payment of the pensions for the privatized agencies and the war-affected policemen were one of the social injustices that this government has redressed. And we couldn't have done it without President Buhari being in the mantle of leadership. We are building strong institutions. PITAT is one of them. With all the reforms we're putting in place, it's in our bid to build strong institutions and leave a legacy so that after we are gone, the changes we put in place will remain for a better Nigeria. Changes here in PITAT. We have restored hope in pension administration.
Having come this far, I sincerely believe that the change has come. Let me go where he is touching more than any other regime in the country. Massive critical infrastructure development. His target is 5,000 kilometers federal roads, 5,000 kilometers of rail lines, additional 5,000 megawatts of electricity, and expansion of the transmission line, because going by the records, it's about 7,000 megawatts today, but they cannot all be wheeled, evacuated into the transmission line. So it's invested about $2.5 billion to have what we call the super grid transmission line. What is it going to do? The Mambila hydroelectric power plant. It was conceived as far back in 1973, but President Muhammadu Buhari is the person that is starting it. He has started. It's a 3-4 years completion cycle. It's going to generate over 3,000 megawatts of electricity. And it's going to irrigate thousands of hectares of farming land. You also have Enugu coal that is going to generate about 1,000 megawatts in mine. Then it puts the wind in renewable energies. It's reactivating the one in the arid areas and windy areas like Katsina. Then there's also other renewables like solar. So when you put what it has in the docket for electricity, in the next 3-5 years, you have additional 5,000 megawatts. Mambila Hydro, about 3,000. Enugu, 1,000. Solar, wind, and mini hydropower plants, you have additional 5,000. For me, it's the most massive infrastructure development being embarked by one regime at a time in a country. What else has changed?